Hi all, welcome to the video series on indirect taxes, more specifically on goods and service tax and customs. As part of today's discussion, we will discuss about some of the important definitions under GST. Before that, the introduction to GST, the legal background, otherwise called as the constitutional aspect of GST. And then we will step into some of the important definitions under GST, which will be having applicability throughout various topics. There are certain definitions which are important from respective topics. Those definitions, we will take it up then and there when it comes on the relevant topic. However, some definitions which are general, that alone we will take it up. With this video, we make a small beginning towards this learning activity. Myself, CA Ganesh Prabhu, a chartered accountant specializing on indirect taxes over a decade, and disseminating knowledge on this topic for over a decade. I am here trying to share some of the experiences under GST as part of this whole learning exercise. Over to the presentation. Coming back here. What is that I need to know about GST? Some doubts might come to some of us. I'm already aware of GST. So yes, I'm not denying. By this time, you will be aware each nook and corner of it. Some important aspects alone I will touch. How it is different from the earlier laws. See, under the erstwhile regime, or to put it in a different way, pre-GST regime, we had different levies on goods and services. For example, we had excise duty if a person manufactured goods. And if he moves from one state to another state, we had something called as entry tax that is levied. In case of services, we had service tax, no doubt about it. Apart from that, we had entertainment tax. And again, when it comes to certain transactions, we had an inclarity. And because of that inclarity, those transactions were leviable to value-added tax, otherwise called as, in simple layman's term, sales tax. Plus, it is also leviable to service tax. Many courts have held, no, this is not a goods, this is a service. No, this is a service, this is not a goods. We had conflicting views, and somehow, this was the pre-GST regime. And under GST, what has changed? Under GST, what government has decided, we will bring here a comprehensive levy. Meaning thereby, be it goods, be it services, or it is going to be a combination of both, it will be leviable to tax as GST. And as it been very rightly held that GST is a levy on supply. When we get into the term supply, we will read in detail, but just appreciate this aspect alone. Supply is a wider term. How much wide? It is wide than sale. It is wide than service. It is the widest term, and we have defined the term supply as part of Section 7 of CGST Act. So under GST, what is leviable to tax when someone questions? It would be supply. The term supply is leviable to tax. As part of our discussions relating to GST, are there any certain other aspects? No doubt it is a single levy. Now, no, sir, I heard CGST, SGST, IGST, you people are sharing to us one nation, one rate, one tax. See, it might be a model, but for our understanding, on a base value, if you say your supply value is going to be 5,000, if you say your supply value is going to be 10,000, on that 10,000, 18% is collected as tax, or 12% is collected, or 28, or 5, as the case may be. Now, on a base value, a tax is collected. Now, what is that important over here for us is, that is, it is a single levy. It's a tax collected on a single value. Just to remind you, our earlier environments, our earlier situations, our pre-GST regime was not like this. Moreover, GST is a multi-point taxation. I'm sure a lot of us are aware. Globally, we have two different types of taxation. One, we will call it as a single point taxation, and the other, we will call it as a multi-point taxation. There are two types of taxation, single point and multi-point. Multi-point means at every stage when the goods crosses, no doubt, tax will be collected by the exchequer. In a single point taxation, either at the manufacturing point or at the retail point, certain countries opted manufacturing point or as the basis for taxation. Certain countries opted the retail as the basis. For example, a country like Germany has decided prior to GST, we will have a single point taxation, which is at the manufacturer level. That is, tax will be collected only at manufacturer level. After that, nowhere it will be collected. Even till today, like GST, I would not say GST, like GST, the USA follows a model called as single point taxation, but at a retail level. At what price it is sold to the consumer, on that price, taxes are collected. Now, a crux discussion for us over here is, under GST, every point, what do we mean by every point? Manufacturer sent to dealer, yes, manufacturer liable to pay tax. Dealer sells to the wholesaler, dealer is liable to pay tax to government. Wholesaler sells to the retailer, wholesaler liable to pay tax. Retailer sells to the consumer, again, retailer is liable to pay tax. No. When everybody pay tax, will it not result in cascading effect? A doubt might come. We are parking this question for a minute. We are parking this question. We will get into this question when we explore it further. But for the time being, understand it is a multi-point taxation. GST is a multi-point taxation. And GST is also called as a destination-based consumption tax. What do we mean by destination-based consumption tax? Very simple. Prior to implementation of GST, during the pre-GST regime, majority of the tax revenues are origin-based taxations. Let me repeat. When you say a supply happens from a particular state, let's say Tamil Nadu, a supply happens from Tamil Nadu to Andhra Pradesh, a doubt comes where the tax revenue should go. Is it to the supplier state? Or is it to the consuming state? In other words, recipient state. So there are two states, a consumption state, a state which consume the goods or services, a supplier state which supply the goods or services. Prior to GST, almost all levy under indirect taxes were under origin-based taxation, which means if I supply goods from Tamil Nadu, revenue will go to Tamil Nadu government when pre-GST regime. Could be sales tax, could be value-added tax, could be entertainment tax, could be service tax, could be excise duty, X, Y, Z taxes, which of list we have over there. To the contrary, in a multi-point taxation, in a destination-based consumption tax, like GST, when Tamil Nadu supply goods to Andhra Pradesh, revenue will go to Andhra Pradesh. That is to say, if a goods is supplied from Tamil Nadu to Andhra Pradesh for rupees 1 lakh and there is a GST of 18,000 rupees at the rate of 18%, that 18,000 rupee revenue will go to Andhra Pradesh government and it will not go to your supplier state. GST is called as a destination based consumption tax. That is why many consuming states like Kerala, states like Goa, where the first few people to came out and accept GST because of a very simple and a single reason that they are the biggest states of consumers. State like Maharashtra, state like Gujarat, state like Tamil Nadu was constantly opposing GST because of a very simple reason. They will see a huge drop in their revenue because they are all producer states, otherwise called as supplier states. Than their domestic consumption, which is within the state, they produce more. And all along they were living in a model called as origin-based taxation. Now, if we push them to a destination-based taxation, it would be tough for them to comply. So, in fact, that is the reason why, understand, earlier there were certain agitation, there were non-cooperation existed. But all this was sorted out by the central government by way of introduction of a compensatory bill by name called as Compensation Cess Act. The GST Compensation Cess Act. Government introduced a GST compensation cess and told, in case if your revenue is going to decrease beyond this percentage, then central government hereby promises that central government will repay that amount. So based on that assurance, yes, everybody proceeded. Now, last learning over here is GST, which stands for Goods and Service Tax, is a comprehensive levy. It is a levy on a term called as supply, which is the most widest term. And it is a single tax collected for goods, services altogether, at least on the international market. Maybe on India, we have tweaked it little different. It's a multi-point taxation, or it is taxed at multiple stages. And the most important one is it's a destination-based consumption tax, meaning thereby the tax revenue will go to the government, which is going to be consuming the goods or services. So I'm sure a lot of us can understand all this. In case you are not able to understand the destination-based consumption tax, my simple point is, recollect your Vodafone advertisement originally, which they used to do with their pug dog, pug breed. Very simple advertisement. A person will walk by and the pug will follow him. As simple as that, Vodafone will come with the tagline, wherever you go, our network follows. Similarly, wherever goods or services goes, your tax also follows. Remember that tagline. I'm sure we can able to appreciate that discussion. I was highlighting GST is a multi-point taxation or a multi-stage taxation. In a multi-point taxation, only one disadvantage we have. We will ask many people to pay tax. When many people pay tax on the same product again and again, there would be an effect called as cascading effect. Always multi-point taxation is criticized by various taxation experts that it would result in cascading effect. Now, how to overcome this cascading effect? Cascading effect means tax on tax concept. That is to say, 10,000 rupees manufacturer is going to supply. Manufacturer will collect a tax, let's say 1,800 rupees. Now, when manufacturer sells to the dealer, the product comes to 11,800, again, dealer is asked to pay one more tax. Now, for the dealer, it comes for 11,800. Dealer will add his margin. Let's say he adds 1,200 as his margin. And he arrives the product price as 13,000. On 13,000, once again, they will pay tax. On tax, on tax, on tax, on tax, again and again, if we pay, it results in a huge cascading effect. How to overcome this? Universal rule to overcome cascading effect is to give tax credits. Let me repeat. The universal rule to overcome cascading effect is to give tax credit. What do you mean by tax credit? Very simple. Whatever tax paid by the supplier for procuring these goods, using these goods, making these goods, and then doing it outward supply, all that are eligible for set off with this output tax. Suddenly you told something, I'm not able to follow what you told. Very simple. A manufacturer sells his goods to a dealer for 10,000 rupees plus 1,800 GST, making up a total invoice value of 11,800. Having arrived at that number, dealer gets a bill for 10,000 value, 1,800 GST, total bill of 11,800. Now, dealer is told, if you have paid any GST on procurement of goods, otherwise called as input GST, procurement of goods, that GST you can set off with your output GST. This fellow got happy. Why? Because he bought the goods for 11,800 for a final net price, including taxes. On this, the 1,800 will not be his cost henceforth. Why? Because a tax credit is eligible on that. On whatever output tax he is going to pay, on that he will adjust. Let's say, after procuring it for 10,000 rupees, he also engaged in the activity of promoting that product, for which he incurred 1,000 or 2,000 rupees as expenses. And on those promotions also, the broadcasting agency or the advertisers collect a GST. Just be reminded. Now, he sells the product for 15,000 rupees to his wholesaler. Dealer sells to the wholesaler for 15,000 rupees. Now, the total GST payable is, rate is same 18%. 15,000 into 18%, we will get about 26,000 of GST payable. Correct? Not 26,000, 2,600. 15,000 into 18%, 15. He sells for 15,000 so that he gets a margin of 3,000 rupees. Now, he sells for 15,000, on that he is liable to pay, let's assume 2,600 or 2,700 rupees. On that 2,700 rupees, now a question comes, is he liable to pay entire 2,700 to government? That is where the twist comes. Because of usage of this word tax credit. On the 2,700, 1,800 is reduced, which tax he is paid at the time of purchase. Again, let's assume he has paid another 400 rupees for working conveniences. I take a different number. 400 rupees for advertisement. On advertisements, there is a tax of 400 rupees. Now, that will also get reduced. So, 2,200 will get reduced. He will pay out of his pocket only 600 rupees. Now, question before us is 600 rupees or whatever number that comes. I'm not bothered about it. 600, 700, some number. My crux discussion is output GST payable minus input GST payable at gross level when we work. Gross level, not at a micro level. At a micro level, you will know about when we get into a topic called as input tax credit, a very detailed discussion. at a gross level. Now we are on the first session. On a gross level, what we can understand. My total tax liability is 2,800. I have an input tax credit of 2,200, 1,800 on raw materials, 400 on services. I get a tax liability of 600 and I pay tax only on that 600. Which means, technically, government has taxed them only on the value addition. So what do you mean by value addition, sir? In costing, we call it as contribution. In GST, we call it as value addition. Okay, that's all of the difference. What is the contribution in this trading activity? For 10,000 rupees, he purchased. 2,000 rupees expenses he incurred. Sir, he paid GST. No, correct. That GST will not be treated as a cost because he is going to set off with his output tax. Hope all of you could able to appreciate. If it is not eligible for set off, then it is a cost. Once it is eligible for set off, then it cannot be a cost. This is a universal rule of costing. When that be the situation, this 1,800 plus 400 on both the items will be eligible as input GST on item, maybe a current asset item. In other current assets below, it will be inserted. If you could able to visualize from a financial statement perspective. Coming back here, when it comes to your costing, 10,000 rupees is the product cost, 2,000 rupees is the promotion cost, 12,000 rupees he sells for 15,000. The net contribution that he has is 15,000 minus 12,000, 3,000. On 3,000, 18% you work. Because I have rounded off, you are not getting the answer. Otherwise, perfect, you will get that answer. The point that I want to drive home is, intention of GST is to tax only the value addition. Intention of GST is to give tax credit so that the disadvantage of a multi-point taxation, which is cascading effect, comes down. So these are the two pillars on which GST sails. So this is a small understanding about a basics of GST. Let us touch the globe and come for a minute. Throughout the world, we are given to understanding more than 160 countries have adopted GST. Some countries have adopted and moved. Some countries have adopted and withdrawn. We have examples for various political, strategic, other reasons. As of today, about approximately 150 countries still operate GST. And the first fellow to start this journey is France. First fellow to come up with a proposal, France, way back in 1949. From there, they have been opting. The whole idea of GST is majority of the products should be taxed. There should be very few exemption, very, very few exemption, because exemption is a bad word in GST. That means, in spite of that, we will learn about exempted goods, exempted services, more probably from an exam perspective, a complete list of more than 132 exempted services. Over the discussions, we will learn, we will spend at least about more than 12, 13 hours on understanding exempted services or decoding exempted services word by word. Coming back here, getting into this discussion. Majority of the countries opted GST. Majority of the countries gave full credit, because if you give full credit only, as I earlier mentioned, cascading effect will come down. But the challenge which India has and the other country does not have is, majority of these country does not have a federal setup like India. In India, we have a different federal setup where center is also powerful, state is also powerful. On state matter, state is powerful. On center matter, center is powerful. Let's for a minute think about all this pandemic, all this which is happening in and around the world now. If you look from a India perspective, the Epidemic Act gives powers only to the state government. In fact, Epidemic Act got amended sometime during 2003 to give powers to the central government. However, you have to treat something as a disaster, then only you can invoke the Disaster Act. Now, of course, subsequently they have invoked that. But originally, when the first lockdown was planned, on that day we had only one act in our hand, Epidemic Act. And on that day, we never had, I mean, or never this was categorized as a disaster. Now, why I want to highlight this point is, under an Epidemic Act, the power to lock down a state is not with the central government. It's with the state government. Under Disaster Management Act, power to lock down is with the central government. See, understand the differences. Within that state, that chair, which is CM chair, is the most powerful chair. When you look as a country, the PM chair is the most powerful chair. The Indian Constitution is worded in such beautifully. It never borrowed the US Constitution, or it never borrowed the UK Constitution. It's a mix by itself. Indian Constitution is unique by itself. In fact, somebody who could able to appreciate the Indian constitutional setup, it's a kind of its signature, no doubt about it. When we go on and when we go ahead and go about it, there are also certain other challenges. Of course, we will take it up subsequently in detail. I just give you as a prelude. Take a situation like taxation. Central government used to levy service tax and excise duty. State government used to levy value-added tax and entertainment tax. On the same transaction, central government also had power to tax, state government also had power to tax. Take a pre-GST regime. Somebody is manufacturing goods. On a goods manufactured, central government can levy central excise duty, state government can levy value-added tax. Both had power. So after introduction of GST in India also, both should have power. That was the biggest challenge for India. When they went into that model and start analyzing the GST, there were two countries which are eligible for comparisons. One was Canada. Because Canadian Constitution and Indian Constitution will have almost same, except for Canadian Constitution will exclude three states inside Canada. Okay, you have some interesting aspects in Canada. Followed by Brazil Constitution and Indian Constitution will have almost same. So that same state center differences will be there. So Indian GST is in line with some of those models of, which will have a lot of influence of Canadian model of GST, where we will call it as dual GST. It is called as a dual VAT there. But of course, dual GST, a lot more about what is dual model and things like that we will learn in our subsequent discussion. To get into the timeline story, no doubt, of late, thanks to Facebook, after that, everybody is interested in timeline. When we go back and touch, rethink the journey of GST over the last more than a decade or so for its implementation. A first official announcement, I still remember vividly, because those days are the days where in which as an article, we used to see budget as a chartered accountant student, a pursuing chartered accountant student, February 28th. Those days it used to be February 28th. Now we have changed the day to February 1st. February 28th is a very auspicious day, because that day in the conference room of the office, through the projector, either in NDTV or in CNBC or some channel, the budget will relay. Majority of the partners and the students will sit and listen. Everybody will have a different takeaway. I still remember in 2006, I listened only one thing, which was para number 196, which came out and told that by 1/4/2010, GST will get implemented. Now, times passed by. the then finance minister, honorable finance minister P. Chidambaram, who was presenting the 2006 budget, would come out and discuss about it. Now, in 2006, a first official announcement comes. Then a committee of state finance ministers is constituted how to go about GST. And they started to discuss how to bring in this model is like this dual model, whatever we saw in foreign countries they adopted, is the still powers need to be there. What goods has to be brought in, what goods need not be brought in. Remember at that time you had a NDA government in power. Which means, in other terms, Congress government is in power. And V.P. Chidambaram, Honorable Finance Minister, he presents the budget. And this word was told, immediately an empowered committee was formed. And then, as part of implementation of GST, there was a tax called a central sales tax. Any transaction that happened between the states was leviable to any transaction that happens between the states was leviable to central sales tax. Though it was collected and administered by the state government, the right to levy was with the central government. Hope you could able to understand. Right to levy is with central government. Power to collect tax is with central government. But the tax was administered by the state government. At that time, it used to be 5%. That 5% got reduced to 3%. They reduced the rate of tax, from 5% to 4%, and then from 4% to 3%. It used to be originally at 5%. So 4 to 3, they reduced. Then we had under the leadership of Dr. Parthasarathy Shom, a very eminent economist who was advisor to His Majesty, UK Queen, a person who has traveled a lot, held various positions across the globe. He was being brought as the person and he has been given the task of coming up with a study paper on GST, whether how GST can be implemented, all that and all. By that time, the 13th Finance Commission report on GST was submitted. Simultaneously, the first discussion paper on GST was released on 2009. Before that, Parthasarathy Shom, they will appoint, once that has been appointed, you will have a separate legislation and levy administration, how it has to be done, how to treat it, whether GST department will be separate or existing department has to be subsumed. All that discussion went on. Again, further GST rate is reduced by 3% to 2%. Somehow in 2009, they came up with a first discussion paper, how GST can be implemented in India. I still remember that year only I have cleared my CA final exams. So somehow destiny was designing. I had little interest inclination on GST. So, I mean, not GST, in indirect taxes. GST ஒன்று வரும் நாளை நாளை வந்தால் நமதே நாடு அப்படின்ற மாதிரிலாம் யோசிச்சிருந்தோம். Okay, all that said and good. Coming back here, the first discussion paper was released. The first discussion paper encapsulated what and all is there. Today what we see, what all are there. It should be a destination-based consumption tax. All goods has to be brought in. In fact, the proposals in the first discussion paper were goods and services both should be leviable to same rate of tax. Somehow that is not brought in the current laws. The current laws, goods are liable to different rate of tax. Services are liable to different rate of tax. Some strategic reason. Maybe when we go to that respective discussions, you all will get convinced why it is like that. But as of today, it is like that. But the first discussion paper never had input tax, credit, valuation, all that single levy, supply, destination-based consumption tax, all was always part of it. 13th Finance Commission report on GST was being presented, which gave certain other recommendations towards it. 2011, a constitutional bill was introduced. Now, why a constitution bill has to be amended? Come on, all along the power to tax under India, power to tax by the government. Some powers are with state government, some powers are with central government. Now you have to delete both the power and bring together, for which there was a need for amending the constitution. So a constitution bill was tabled in the parliament, followed by a committee of finance ministers again was constituted sometime during 2013. And that standing committee again formed an executive committee. That executive committee rejected the proposal to include petroleum products. A petroleum product will be included in GST or not was a very serious subject matter of debate, because understand there were only two revenue points or two big important revenue pullers for the state. Preferably this discussion is from a state perspective. For example, I would share you Tamil Nadu revenue so that you can understand. Tamil Nadu commercial tax collections, 80,000 crores. Of this 80,000 crores, approx, 78-76, some number, 80,000 crores, approx, okay. Because 2017-18, it was 76,000 crores, 18-19, it was 78,000 crores, and it should be now 80,000 crores. Of 80,000 crores, understand, 38,000 crores comes from two products. Any rough guess? Petroleum product and liquor. Sir, among them, sir, equally, both one which fuels the motor, one more which fuels the fellow member of this nation. Okay. Now, why I want to be specific here is, understand, not only for this state. If you go to Pondicherry and all, it is pathetic. Number is 80% comes from petrol and liquor. Go to Goa. 85% comes from liquor. And don't ask me what is special about it. See, those are the states, those are the places where that product was becoming prominent. Now, you take on an average any other state, Maharashtra, again, you'll have 50%. Because of that reason, a strong opposition from the finance minister of the state, and the executive committee rejected the plea that petroleum products cannot be brought in into GST. So again, see, as a party, as a India, you have to oblige to your state politicians, state parties. And at that time, yes, it has to be taken care. So a revised constitution bill is presented, wherein which a revised constitution bill, which was tabled earlier, sometime during 2011, which will exclude petroleum products, was decided, and then it was to lay forward. Somehow 2014 was a little bad. The next government comes, the election came, the two terms of UPA, if you carefully note, that is a 2004 only they will come. 4, 5, next 6 itself they'll announce. Okay. The down of UPA, then the rise of NDA comes. When NDA comes, one of their agenda was to implement GST. When they came, they completely rejected the earlier bill. They never bothered about the earlier bill. They completely rejected. What has happened is, again, a new committee was formed under the leadership of Asim Das Gupta. And then a new constitution bill was placed in the Lok Sabha. 122nd Constitution Amendment Bill, if my memory serves me right. Sometime during 2015. Once that was being tabled, the executive or an empowered committee was being appointed to handle the business process and all. filing of registration, payment of tax, how the revenue to be distributed, how returns is going to be filed, how registration is going to happen. So all that was discussed. And then a model GST law was released sometime during 2016. By the time Rajya Sabha gave its assent, from the day in which Rajya Sabha gave its assent, by next few 1 week, the president has given its assent on 7th September 2016. Exactly, that is the date. From 2016, a GST Amendment Act came, 101 Constitution Amendment Act. Actually, it is Constitution only, 101st Amendment to Constitution of India. So that is why we call it as 101 Constitution Amendment Act, 2016. That went and amended various sections so that the power to tax is with the government. Very interesting to note, after the implementation of this bill, 101 Constitution Amendment Bill, within 1 year, the old law powers will get deleted. Strategic move, mark my word. Strategic move, very, very strategic move, because people cannot fight. They have to come and follow. I was bothering because you have to go back again, history only. All this is history. Last 10, 12 minutes is history. And any history is interesting if you want to go deeper into the topic. Being a person sitting in Tamil Nadu, specializing on indirect taxes, and decided exclusively an indirect tax practice we have to do and specialize on that. The Tamil Nadu government has never notified this GST law at all. Till which date? 31st March 2017. And on the last day, he notified. On the day, I still remember. There are only two people this world will remember. One, the fellow who came first, Assam, was the first person to accept the new constitution provisions in its state legislature. And the one who comes last. Okay. Be it value-added tax, be it GST, Tamil Nadu was the last to accept it. Various strategic political reasons, I'm not stepping into it, but just understand these are all. In fact, with due respect, at that time, the situation of Tamil Nadu was a little different. We had the loss of the CM, again, who's the next CM, decisions on the ministries, portfolio, understanding. All that had its own differences. Coming back here, on to the introduction of GST. Some of the benefits of GST, no doubt it is a simplified legislation. People can call it complex again and again, but understand, as compared to the earlier legislations that are there in India, no doubt it's a simplified legislation. Come on, understand, what we read is applicable throughout of India, something like income tax. Never an indirect tax legislation was like this. But for service tax and excise duty, every state was having its own law, its own forms, its own methods, its own process of registration. No unified approach. Today you have a complete unified approach, and that's the simplicity of GST. Followed by, we have a seamless market. Let me repeat, a very seamless market. A very, very common and a seamless market. Throughout India, rate of tax is same. Throughout India, exemptions are same. Throughout India, process is same. Filing of return is same. Everything is same, which makes the goods and supply of goods and services competitive. Earlier, many strategies were drawn to supply goods. Now, no, clear, very clear. These are all on the advantages end. It doesn't mean nothing comes without a disadvantage. Yes, the SME segment, the tiny manufacturer, small and tiny manufacturer, they were all finding it difficult because for them, computers are new. For them, everything is digitalized. They have to live with only that kind of digitalization. Affordability of a resource person, affordability of a consultant, you all that was costly for them. And moreover, that SME segment was that time just 1 year before was slapped by the demonetization. Once again, when they next year they have to take up GST, that industries were not ready. And in a country like India, you have a lot of SMEs. Approx, we have 80 lakh plus SMEs, small and medium enterprises. So you cannot, without SME, India cannot survive at all. So coming back here, that was the disadvantage of it. Nobody claims on the structure and all. And of course, few changes initially we had, at least for the last first 6 months, I would say, though the act was implemented sometime during July, until finally till December, it took till December 2017 to get settled in terms of the rate. After that, not a big rate change comes. Until that time, too much of shuffling. What was something under 18% was suddenly next day brought to 5%. Of course, it's all properly represented. That is a downside you can see. On the positive note, how you can see is, see, when an industry player goes and represent, the council is ready to take it up. So those were the positives. But of course, we had disadvantages. We have resource cost. We have changes in the information technology, changes in the process, changes in the modalities. Business earlier, take a telecom company and all, they had a single registration running the whole show earlier, pre-GST regime. And when it comes to GST, state-wise, they have to take registration, which was new to that company. Company was not prepared for it. I'm talking of a size of a telecom company. Take the India's, the best of 3-4 telecom companies. First 6 months, they find it very, very tough. For a telecom company who has so much resources, for them itself is tough means, then think of what would be the fate of a SME. That were the downsides, no doubt it has to be accepted. Coming back here, in India, we opted GST in a dual model. What do we mean by dual model? There would be two supply. Supply can be broadly categorized into two types of supply. An interstate supply and an intrastate supply. An intra and an interstate supply. When a supply of goods or services which is leviable to tax within the state, if something is leviable to tax within the state, then it will be treated as intrastate supply. If a supply of goods or services is leviable to tax because the movement is inter, or the supply of services between states, then it would be treated as interstate supply. How to determine that? That's a separate discussion. But understand, broadly, dual model of GST we follow. If a transaction happens within a state, we call it as intrastate supply. If a transaction happens between states, we call it as interstate supply. Coming back here, intrastate supply means it will be leviable to CGST and SGST. Central Goods and Services Tax, State Goods and Services Tax. Wherever it is not a state, it is a union territory, it would be treated as Union Territory Goods and Services Tax. Followed by, if a transaction is going to be between states, then yes, it would be treated as Integrated Goods and Services Tax, IGST, Integrated Goods and Services Tax. Moving forward, post this discussion, taxes that are subsumed under GST, what are those taxes that are subsumed under GST? When we want to have that discussion, from the central government end, excise duty is subsumed. Subsumed means which is absorbed in GST. After that, that provisions are all deleted. You will not have a levy of those kind of taxes because you have in place now GST. That is the intention of it. The central government taxes that are subsumed are excise duty, which is levied whenever goods are manufactured in India. There was something called as additional excise duty, which was levied on certain products alone, like tobacco, textile, or it is going to be your goods of special importance, some of the notified goods. Followed by service tax was subsumed. Again, CVD, SAD from customs perspective. When goods are imported, a tax in lieu of customs that was there, which will be customs in lieu of excise duty was levied, which is called as CVD. And in lieu of local VAT, it was levied, called as SAD. Those are all deleted. As I earlier mentioned, central sales tax got removed and various cesses, about 31 different type of cess was there in the pre-GST regime. All that cess got removed. On the state front, value-added tax, octroi, entry tax. Octroi is otherwise called as local body tax. As far as local body tax or octroi, both are concerned, the whole discussion is something like this. If goods comes from one place to another place, from any goods comes to Bombay, will be liable for this local octroi or entry tax. Any goods comes to Bombay. So some states had purchase tax. If you purchase goods from agriculturist, very popular, now we will call it as reverse charge, but in the erstwhile sales tax regime, we used to call it as purchase tax. Big revenue for purchase tax is, for Punjab, purchase tax is the biggest revenue. For Bombay, octroi is the biggest revenue, otherwise called as local body tax. For Tamil Nadu, entry tax is not the biggest revenue. Luxury tax, which has been collected from the hotel as part of the state government share. For again, Maharashtra, lottery betting gambling was one of the biggest revenue. Certain states banned lottery. Some states still have betting and gambling, which are allowed. Again, state cess, entertainment tax levied by state government. Very interesting to note. Now, entertainment tax is still there. It can be levied by local authority, local body. Okay, we call it as LBET, local body entertainment tax, now levied. Earlier, that power was with state government, now moved to local body because there is a need for it. Now, this is a list of just for the understanding purposes, the list goes for the bigger. Major central government taxes such as excise duty, additional excise duty, service tax, central sales tax. Major taxes subsumed. When it comes to state, there are major taxes, revenue of taxes, value-added tax, octroi or entry tax, purchase tax, luxury tax. That got subsumed under SGST. Getting into the legal background, whatever we have discussed, all our introduction to GST, don't get carried away, sir. All I know, sir, good, happy for you. Okay. Sir, I had some military insights, good. So whatever be it, so whatever we have discussed, all are in relation to your introduction to your GST. Legal background. The Bible for the country is the book that is before you. Constitution of India. When it comes to its legal background, Constitution of India. Okay. Or otherwise, you can also call it as constitutional background. Prior to implementation of GST, I'm sure a lot of you would have been aware about it. Central government had certain power to levy taxes, preferably on manufacture, service, central sales tax in case of interstate movement. State government had power to tax, which is tax on goods, sales tax on goods, and again, entry tax, entertainment tax, luxury tax on services. Now, what is the need is, you should give power to central government to tax sale of goods. You should give power to state government to tax manufacture of goods. Can you able to appreciate this? Central government had no power for levy of tax on sale of goods. All along it was, prior to implementation of GST, all along it was a state government portfolio, state government kitty. State government never had power to tax on manufacture of goods or services because all along it was a central government power. Both has to be deleted and we have to step in with a new process. Now, why I want to highlight this discussion is very simple. To do all this, we have to rewrite our constitution. As I earlier mentioned, the parliament, before the parliament, the constitution bill was placed both in Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. It got its assent, which got its acceptance in both the Sabha, and the president has signed, and then it becomes the law of land. Now, in constitution, often we refer it as article, we don't refer it as section. That's the model. That's the model in which it has been followed. Article 366, definitions will be the second section in every act. However, in constitution, Article 366 discuss about various definitions. Two definitions are inserted, 12A and 26A. The other definition, I just brought it for our references. A definition is getting inserted. Goods and service tax means any tax on supply of goods or services or both, except taxes on supply of alcoholic liquor for human consumption. So GST means a tax. It can be any tax on supply of goods, services or both. So it can be a tax on goods, it can be a tax on services, it can be a tax on both. Good. But very interesting to note, except one goods, which is alcoholic liquor meant for human consumption. Except alcoholic liquor, all the other products are leviable to GST, or GST can be levied. What is service is defined. A beautiful definition, an extraordinary definition. I like this definition very much. Service means anything other than goods. Then again, what is goods? Goods includes, look at that word, goods includes, it's an inclusive definition. All material, commodities, and articles. So if it is a material or a commodity or an article or a substance or something which is movable, then it will be treated as goods. Anything other than goods is what? Services. Basic definition, constitution definition, don't be bothered. This is a definition as per Constitution of India. Under CGST Act, you have a separate definition, 2 subsection 52 and 2 subsection 102 defines the term both goods and services. So that's separate. That discussion is separate. This is from the Constitution perspective. One question might be lingering on our mind. Why alcoholic liquor is excluded? Why that benefit? Very simple. Power to tax alcoholic liquor is with the state government. It is not with central government at all. Even not today. From years in which we had a constitution, always power to tax the liquor will be with the state government. Under erstwhile excise regime also, when we manufacture goods also, we said all goods except alcoholic liquor for human consumption. Simple note. Instead of using word entry to, Article 246, which used to give power for taxation, Article 246, in its 7th schedule, it has 3 lists. List 1, List 2, List 3. List 1, central government exclusively will have power to tax. 1 month. The one that we referred here are part of the List 1. Be it excise duty, be it service tax, be it central sales tax, be it all those cesses, surcharges that are levied, be it customs duty, all are covered under List 1. Similarly, List 2 gives powers to state government. List 2 gives powers to state government, where it could be value added tax octroi, entertainment tax, purchase tax, luxury tax, all these powers comes from list 2. Article 246 is the power that gives, Article 246 is the article which gives power for levy of taxes. This is what is origin point. This is what is your Gangotri. Article 246 in its list 2 very clearly told the power to tax liquor is always with the state court. What tax, sir? Both central excise, sorry, state excise tax at the time of manufacture and state VAT at the time of sale. Even today, under GST, liquor is not brought into GST. People will give 1,000 reasons, but no one will give this conceptual clarity. I'm sorry. I know people who come out and say, why liquor is not brought? Many people drink, no? That's why liquor is, if many people drink, then too much of consumption will happen. If you tax that, government and all is not like that. See, government shows how much hurry in opening the liquor shops. In and around, you will know. Very simple reason. The biggest source of revenue for every state government is liquor, sale of liquors. You go and analyze it, you yourself will be convinced that the biggest source is liquor. Now, points for our discussion here in case of liquor is an item, constitutionally power to tax is only with the state government. Central government has no role and state governments were not ready to relinquish that power. They told, I want one goods always to be taxed by me. Super, which go. Which goods is liquor. So that is the reason why it is not brought in. Understand. Constitutionally, a new article comes into place which gives power for levy of I'll rephrase it. Which give power for levy of GST to both central government and state government. An article called as Article 246A, capital A. Article 246A overrides. Overrides means is a special section. Among two sections, which is the most superior section, often when we have doubt, the language of the section or the language of the article will give us. Is it Article 246 is superior or Article 246A is superior? Article 246A, because of usage of the word notwithstanding anything contained in Article 246 and 254, because those are the taxation related article. Whatever told in Article 246 is not applicable to 246A. In case of intrastate supply means supply happens within the state. In case of intrastate supply, union or state have the powers to make laws. Article 246A, which gives powers to levy of GST, comes out and gives a very important power when it comes to a supply that happens within the state, otherwise called as intrastate supply. In case of intrastate supply, the power to tax will be with union or state. Whenever in article Constitution of India articles, they refer a word union, means it is the central government. Union, that is why you would come across some case laws as Union of India, which means the case is against central government, or Tamil Nadu, state of Tamil Nadu. So that means state government. Both will have power when a transaction is an intrastate supply. If a transaction is an interstate supply, then Parliament will have exclusive powers to make law. If it is intrastate supply, both the government will have power. If it is interstate supply, only the central government will have power or Parliament will have power. Kindly make a note. 4-5 slides before, we saw model. in the same way as the Constitution is not drafted. This is what was told in the first discussion paper. We will have intrastate supply, interstate supply. This is how your Constitution today it is. If it is an intrastate supply, both the government have power to tax, central and state. If it is an interstate supply, only central government will have power to tax, make laws and everything. When we say about intrastate supply and interstate supply, we talked about supplies happen within the state, within Tamil Nadu. When a supply happens between Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh. In case if a transaction happens between India and USA, India and Japan, India and Germany, India and yet another country, what would happen? Was a doubt for many of us. For which, again, another article, Article 269A. Let me repeat it. Some of us will have this question in our mind. Do I need to remember these numbers? Mark my word. If the article number is important only, I will share. For that matter, in the whole of my session, if I share a section number, that is important. If I share a subsection number, then it becomes most important. If I refer it as 16-2A, I am sorry, you have to remember that. If somewhere I come out and say 17-5, you have to remember that. If somewhere I come out and say it is Article 279A, you have to remember that. Why I want to highlight here upfront itself, these are all some important references, numbers, which are often expected at your level. At your level, being pursuing a professional course at a helm of its level. So you are expected to know all this. Now coming back here, Article 269A, which simply discusses about the levy and collection of GST in case of interstate trade or commerce. That is to say, in case of import of goods or services, it will be deemed, let me repeat, it will be deemed, it is in the course of interstate trade or commerce. Any goods imported into India, any services imported into India, it will be deemed, it is in the course of interstate trade or commerce. Hence, import of goods, import of services will be liable for interstate, as it is an interstate supply, will be liable for IGST. Of course, when it comes to goods, at the time of customs duty, calculation of customs duty itself, IGST is collected. For import of services, we have reverse charge. How it is collected, leave it. But if a transaction is between Japan to India, Australia to India, or Malaysia to India, Singapore to India, who have power to tax? State government or central government? That was the lacuna we had. Central government will have power to tax both in case of import and export. No doubt about it. Import, export. More specifically, they want to clarify for import. They brought in Article 269A. One among the important constitutional acts. Moving forward. In case of Article 246A, post introduction of that, along with that different articles that are all introduced, there are also certain amendments in the existing entries of various entry in constitution. more specifically Article 246, Article 279, all these various entries got examined. To come back here, the entries in the 7th schedule, we have already discussed Article 246, 7th schedule in its list 1 gives powers to various transactions on which central government can levy tax. Now, one of the duty earlier used to be a excise duty on all goods other than alcoholic liquor meant for human consumption. Now look at the wording. Now, even today, there is a levy of excise duty. If you're going to ask me, yes, there is a levy of excise duty, no doubt. But that levy of excise duty is just restricted to the 6 products. Now, if you're going to ask me, do I need to remember the 6 products? Yes, nothing great about it. Crude oil, petrol, diesel, aviation turbine fuel, natural gas, and tobacco products. So, 6 items. Now, government consciously decided, once the state governments agree for it, and once GST Council, later we will learn, you all would have known by this time, a term called as GST Council. Once GST Council approves, the petroleum product will form part of GST, which means only one item will be liable to excise duty. Let me repeat, a duty of excise can be collected. One item will be liable to excise duty, which is tobacco. To put it in a different way, the only item in India which is liable for excise duty, central excise duty and GST, is tobacco. Now, as of today, 2 products are there, which is petroleum products and tobacco. What would happen is, the day in which the government accepts, which is not going to happen now, maybe at 2021, 2022, someday. See, once upon a time, you have to bring petroleum into GST. Actually, the mood was to bring sometime during October 2018. But because of the little slowdown that started at that time, and then it taken out in a very aggressive way, and then the economic sluggishness that were there quarter after the quarter, and then outbreak of pandemic, all this pushed the government not to be part of it, because as I earlier told, if it comes, it has to be taxed at the peak rate. In spite of taxing at the peak rate, the government will not get its desired revenue. Just for your information, no. When you go to the relevant sections, you all will know maximum GST that can be collected from a product by central government is 20%, state government is 20%. Just for your information, roughly I'll share. Central government can make its money because central government's rate max works out to 19%. Excise duty of 16%, plus this, plus that, plus all that put together. On an average, every state government charges petroleum products 25% VAT. States like Tamil Nadu charge 33% VAT. During this pandemic, they have in fact increased it. Now, why I want to highlight all these as part of your discussion, it's very simple. Because this product had its doubt, government said, no doubt, petroleum products are liable for GST. But the decision whether petroleum products will be brought into GST or not alone will be decided by the GST Council, or in consultation with GST Council, it will be later decided. Same in the case of, if you see, same in the case of list 2, which discuss about the powers of the state list, entry 54. If you carefully note, again, taxes on sale of petroleum, crude, high-speed diesel oil, motor sprints or natural gas, aviation turbine fuel, or liquor meant for human consumption. Okay. A very interesting to note here. All those, here also 6 products, but only difference is 5 products of petroleum products and 6th product is liquor meant for human consumption. The day in which GST is applicable on petroleum products, these 2 entry will get deleted and you will have central government levying excise duty on tobacco products, state government levying VAT on liquor. state government will have one product, central government will have one product. In fact, that is the agenda of them to have one product. Luxury and entertainment tax earlier was with state government power, now goes to panchayat and municipality. So these are the major change in the legislature. So that alone was brought into you. A new article is getting introduced, Article 279A. A new article will be introduced and it will get its assent once the 122nd amendment bill, constitution amendment bill, when it is getting accepted. And once the assent is given by the president, and with the next 60 days, and once the constitution amendment bill is placed in the Lok Sabha and presented in Rajya Sabha, once it gets its assent, after it getting its assent, within 60 days, more than 50% of the state, more than 50% of the state changes or adopts these changes, constitution changes in their state legislature, then the president from that day, within 60 days, will form a council called as GST Council. Now, what is this GST Council? It is called as Goods and Service Tax Council, where the chairman of the GST Council is the Union Finance Minister. And of course, the Union Minister of State, which is otherwise called as all those MOS, Minister of State, those people are also member of the GST Council. Every state finance minister is given one seat, which means every state finance minister are automatically members of the GST Council. Why you want the council? See, a decision has to be taken cohesively. Decisions with regard to what is the rate of tax, what product is exempted, how the law has to be, how you should determine the place of supply, what is the threshold for turnover, similarly, what will be the rate of tax for goods, what will be the rate of tax for services, so how the business process for refund has to be decided, returns has to be decided, when we can bring in the taxability of petroleum, so on and so forth. On all these matters, first discussions, deliberations, among them clarifications, all will happen at the GST Council level. And based on the recommendations of the GST Council, central government and state government will amend their respective laws. So it is both the government comes together, work for the development of nation, which is a body constituted as per the Constitution of India, Article 279A. We had MCQs which are all picked up on these numbers. Then what is GSTN, Goods and Service Tax Network? Goods and Service Tax Network is a Section 8 company under the Companies Act, which means a non-profit company, non-government company, no doubt. The purpose of incorporating GSTN is to provide a complete information technology infrastructure to both the governments. Very interesting to note, the shareholding pattern as it stands today will be central government, state government, HDFC, HDFC Bank, ICICI Bank, NSE, and LIC. If you carefully note, 24.5% will be with central government and balance 24.5% with state government. And HDFC Bank has a little higher stake of 20% through its branch and its corporation. ICICI Bank has about 10%, and NSE, National Stock Exchange, that has about 10%, and LIC, Housing Finance Limited. Again, it's part and parcel of the central government. 11% they have. Now, this is the manner in which they fund it, and the purpose is to generate revenue to do at a particular cost level to make its own surplus. But the idea here is to provide a beautiful infrastructure, technology infrastructure. For what? It could be for return, it could be for payment of tax, it could be for refund, it could be for assessment, filing, registration, audits, appeals, for everything. Purpose of GSTN is to provide everything on a technology platter. These are all the functions. Some of them are statutory functions, some of them are non-statutory functions. For example, statutory functions are the compliances relating to registration, payment of tax, filing of refund, refund, audit, assessment. All these are all statutory functions where they have to do. Some of them are non-statutory functions, which is help desk services, support services, distribution of revenue between central government and state government, or it is going to be the data analytics, which in which they sit in GSTN sits in a huge amount of data. The data that which GSTN sits, it's unimaginable. On sitting up that data, they can predict many things. And of course, they are here to decide on certain parameters, how to detect fraud, special circumstances. Many reports can be for those analysis also there. So the purpose of GSTN, Goods and Service Tax Network, is just to support the implementation, successful implementation of GST through a technology platform. So these are the functions of GSTN, and only for this purposes we have incorporated a company, and whose main work as a SPV, special purpose vehicle, whose only work will be doing these activities. Hope you could have a glimpse of what is GSTN, what is Goods and Service Tax Council. Hope you can have, they're all purposes different. GSTN purpose is provide everything through technology, serve through technology, everything. GST Council is the alma mater. They decide everything. Only after their concurrence, everything comes. If a state government comes to the problem, central government comes to the problem, they sit, discuss, analyze, take a decision, close it, and say, you pass recommendation. As this is our recommendation, you pass necessary notification circular based on these. So, coming back here. Getting into a very crucial topic called as body of GST law. What do we mean by body of GST law? If I want to know completely about GST, what and all I should refer? If someone has a doubt, they have to refer all these 4-5 items. To start with, someone has to read through CGST Act, SGST Act, IGST Act, and GST compensation system. Sir, 4 acts, sir? Yeah, we have 4 acts. But very interesting to note, if someone is aware of CGST, Central Goods and Service Tax, completely, automatically he is aware of SGST Act, because verbatim it will be safe. IGST Act, but for about 10-15 sections, which are all unique, applicable only to IGST Act. Rest all is referred to CGST Act. GST Compensation Cess Act is a very small act. Purpose of that GST Compensation Cess is to distribute revenue to the respective state. Distribute the compensation cess to the respective state. Having said that, so if I read CGST Act, will it be able? Yes, predominantly if you read CGST Act, it is default you understood every state SGST Act as it one and the same. The Act will come out and say what has to be done. If you ask the Act how to do it, in case if you're going to ask the Act, okay, how to do that, then Act will say, come on, refer my delegated legislation or subordinate legislation or rules, however you're going to call it as. It is below the Act. We have something called as CGST rules, SGST rules, and IGST rules. Of course, GST compensation for rules also there. Because everything requires registration. Any person who crossed 20 lakhs has to get himself registered. Section 22 will comfortably say. But next question you all will ask me, sir, which form, sir? Within how many days, sir? What is the prerequisite, sir? Whether I should have email ID or mobile number? Whether OTP will come to mobile number or email ID? See, if you ask me too many questions, I'll say, wait, I am active. My work is only to say whether you have to get registered or not. How to register, which form to file and all is not my duty. For that, go to rules. Rules will say all this. If there is a change in the process required in terms of the rules, that change in the process comes through a notification. Again, rate of tax. What is the rate of tax for various products? Not all goods liable at same rate of tax. Not all services are liable at same rate of tax. See, we are in a country like India. And in a country like India, we have 100 Mercedes-Benz is also sold. 1,000 Maruti Alto also sold in a country. So, Maruti Alto and Mercedes-Benz, let's say C-Class, cannot be taxed at the same rate. One is a less than 800cc engine. The other is a 3600cc engine. So both are at different levels. So my tax should also be a little different. If somebody makes a car less than 800cc engine, I will tax them at 18% GST. Somebody sells a car at more than so much cc engine, I'll tax them at 28%. So the idea is the tax has to be distributed. It has to have its differences. Someone comes and stay in a hotel, in a room. Let's all of us would have traveled. We would have traveled to various states, various cities, and we would be staying one night in a room. Maybe we were prepared to pay 2,000 rupees, 2,500 rupees, sometime okay, 4,000, 5,000 rupees. But here you have a hotel which gives you fifth floor for a rental of rupees, 1,25,000 rupees per day. Let me repeat, of course, it's a suite room, no doubt about it. It's one of the star hotels in the city. Agreed. But my point here is, somebody who pays 4,000 rupees rent per day, somebody who pays 1,25,000 rupees per as rent per day, you cannot treat them same. Maybe somebody who pays 4,000 rupees per day, you can tax him at 18%. Somebody who is prepared to pay 1,25,000, you should tax him at 28%, no doubt about it. Again, there are rooms available at 1,500 rupees. Now take 1,500 and 4,000. Again, it's not comparable. For a day, somebody is ready to pay only 1,000, a little more than 1,000, 1,200. For them, that itself is pinching. For them, the 1,200 is tough. If that be the case, you cannot tax. So, because of that reason, government went for a thorough understanding, and wherever possible, let me repeat, honestly I'm sharing, wherever possible, they have reduced the rate. They have reduced the rate very much to the extent possible. 1 minute. Coming back here, the point to be noted down by us over here is there would be possibilities that there are a change in rate of tax. Again, there would be possibilities where changes in the process, procedure, in the rules, for all which notifications are issued. If the government want to clarify a particular stand, yes, we have circulars that are issued by the government to clarify the position taken by the government. So these are all the prominent body of law. Of course, we don't have any great case laws, but for certain writs that are getting disposed by the government. Act, rules, notification, circular, case law. All these five are the body of GST law. And whenever we have doubts, we'll always make decisions referring to all these in associated to GST. As usual, this act extends to whole of India. Of course, for the first 7 days, it was extending only to whole of India other than Jammu and Kashmir. But after that, the act will be extending to whole of India. And again, some of us will have a doubt, what is India? Yes, for all of you here, we have India on our screen. So landmass, airspace, seabed, subsoil, continental shelf, contiguous zone, exclusive economic zone, and other maritime zone would be treated as India. Very simple, the complete landmass, and after the landmass, territorial waters. What do we mean by territorial water? From the baseline, 12 nautical miles territorial water. Then continental shelf. From the baseline, 24 nautical mile, or from the territorial water, another 12 nautical mile. Baseline, 24 nautical mile is continental shelf, where certain rights are given, rights for exploration, all that and all. Exclusive economic zone, where the exploration right of India extends up to exclusive economic zone, which is 200 nautical mile from baseline. And any seabed, subsoil inside over there, or all that small territories, islands, all that would be treated as India. When it comes to airspace, the airspace above the landmass and the territorial water would be treated as India. So, if any services provided in the air, any services provided in the land, any services provided in the water, all are happening in India, and the law would apply. A very important definition called as goods. As I earlier mentioned, goods and service, both word are defined. Goods means every kind of movable property. So it should be a movable property, every kind of movable property, other than money and securities. Money is not a goods, securities is not a goods. But it includes actionable claim, growing crops, grass and things attached to or farming part of the land, which are agreed to be severed before supply or under a contract of supply. Meaning thereby, anything that is movable is goods. Money and securities is not goods, but there is going to be an actionable claim. It could be an instrument other than a debt instrument. Maybe an insurance policy, which is after the death of the person, would be treated as an actionable claim. A lottery ticket, where after the lucky dip number is announced and the ticket which you have in the hand is the one which gives you or entitled you to get a benefit or get a prize money, then it would be treated as an actionable claim. These are all examples of actionable claims. All those growing crop, where the idea is not to sell the land, to cut and sell the crop. Yes, it is goods. So goods means basically every kind of movable property. But money and securities. Securities means we have a definition which says securities as per SCRA. Securities Contract Regulation Act, you all would have seen share, debenture, bonds, commercial paper, this, that, negotiable instrument, everything. You have a definition 2E of Security Contract Regulation Act. Now, points here is anything that is movable is goods, other than money and securities. Actionable claims are goods. All those crops, trees, or grasses, or whatever it might be, they are all agreed that it would be cut and then supplied under a contract of supply, then yes, it would be treated as goods. Followed by services. Section 2102 defines the term services. Service means, look at that word, very strange, dangerous word. Service means anything other than goods, money, and securities. I'll stop here. Anything is goods. Look at that wideness it brings. If you take a paper and if you put a circle and say it is movable, the circle items are all movable, then that small circle is goods. Rest full white paper is service. That is the wideness service has. Service means anything other than goods, money, and securities. And it includes activities relating to use of money, its conversion by cash or any other mode from one form of currency or denomination to another form of currency or denomination. what we are trying, nothing great. Conversion of cash or any other mode from one form of currency or denomination. You had $5,000, you gave the $5,000 to your exchange rate and asked them to credit your account. That's all. Conversion of currency. You had in your debit card 10,000 rupees and you wanted some $500. You showed him, swipe my card and give me $500 in cash. An exchange of one currency to another currency. Yes, it would be treated as a supply of services. No doubt, it would be treated as a supply of services. So these are all some of the entries that we have over here in terms of those. When it comes to goods, the one aspect that needs to be noted is goods should be movable in nature. Similarly, when it comes to services, the other aspect that needs to be noted is it is other than goods, money and securities. Of course, money and securities is also not goods. So these terms becomes more important when it comes to analyzing certain situation where whether something is a goods or whether something is a service. First, it has to be either a goods or a service. Then only it will be leviable to GST. If something is neither a goods nor a service, then it will not be leviable to GST. Again, as we earlier highlighted, any use of money or any conversion of cash into one form of currency or denomination or any other currency from one currency, foreign currency to Indian currency, all that for a separate consideration, then it would be treated as a supply of a service. Don't come out and say, no, I have given money and taken money. For example, if in case it is going to be a transaction where somebody gives you a 500 rupee note and in turn you give them 500 rupee note, no doubt it is a transaction in money. But that does not result in service. Here we have somebody giving you $500 and in turn you are making payment to them in terms of INR. And there is going to be a separate consideration charge for it, or the consideration is imbibed in the exchange rate itself, then yes, it would be treated as a supply of services. A very old definition which we are comfortable with, the term called as person. Person, again, an inclusive definition. Person includes individual, HUF, company, AOP, BOI, whatever we saw, everything. Company. Very interesting to note, this time government, they want to be very clear, even central government, state government, society, trust, cooperative society, everything is considered as person. No doubt it is an inclusive definition. So in simple terms, you can always say a person can be either a natural person or a legal person. Persons can be broadly classified into two types, universally. This is a general understanding. But in case specifically, if someone wants, is the term person is defined under GST? Yes, we have individual, HUF, company, firm, LLP, AOP, BOI, or a corporation established under Central Act, State Act, or any other act, or it is going to be a body corporate, incorporated, or under the law outside India. So all those body corporates would be treated as a person. Well, a big signal that yes, government is going to be considered as person. A very simple definition. Supplier, no doubt, most important term, key term. Supplier means the person who is supplying the said goods or services. If he is going to be involved in supplying the goods or services, then yes, he would be treated as supplier. And similarly, and it also includes his agent who is acting on behalf of the supplier. Similarly, a very important key term, agent. As far as recipient is concerned. Sorry. When it comes to supplier, a very important term, no doubt. Any person engaged in involving supplying the goods or services. If he is going to supply the goods or services, he is going to provide the services. For example, being a chartered accountant, I am providing chartered accountancy services. there would be a consultant. He would be providing consultancy services. There would be a repair and maintenance guy. He would be providing repair and maintenance services. In a common parlance term, all of us are treated as suppliers because they are involved in supplying goods or services. Now, I would be taking a franchisee, or I would be acting as an agent on behalf of some other supplier of goods or some other supplier of service. Even then, at that time, even if I am an agent, I would be treated as a supplier. That is the crux point over there. Recipient, yes, as usual, same terminology. In relation to any goods or services where the consideration is payable. Recipient is broadly categorized into when consideration payable, not consideration not payable. Maybe now we will not be able to appreciate the importance of the term consideration not payable. Over a period of time, yes, we would definitely appreciate the term, why the word is used there. But in relation to any goods or services, for supply of goods or services, the person who is liable to pay the consideration. For the services provided by me, if you are going to pay consideration, then no doubt you are a recipient. Sometimes, consideration is not payable. Sir, when it will happen? When you go to supply, you will come across certain situation, transaction happening between head office, between head office and branch office would be treated as supply. In this background or in this situation, a small doubt will come. Will head office will pay branch office or branch office will pay head office? Actually, no, they will not pay. Those are all the categories of people where no consideration is payable in terms of service or in terms of supply of goods. When a factory supply goods to its branch, okay. When a factory supply goods to its own head office, of course, both of them are going to be located in different state, not within the same state. This law creates a deeming fiction. To come out of that, we had a specific entry. In case where consideration is not payable, the place where the goods are delivered or the place where the person, where the goods are in possession or made available to another person or the place where the service is rendered, that person, to whom the person it is rendered, to whom the goods are given, to whom custody the goods are made available, that person would be treated as recipient. Similarly, it also includes an agent acting on behalf of the recipient. Supplier agent is very common, but we are talking of recipient agent, i.e. being a multinational company involved in agro products. I want some 1,500 metric ton. Understand? 1,500, not kgs, 1,500 metric ton, which means 1,500 multiplied by 1,000. Each metric ton is 1,000 kgs. Daily, I want 1,500 metric ton of wheat. I'm interested to buy only 1,500 metric ton. What I would do is, I will appoint an agent in Punjab, if I'm going to be ITC, I'll appoint an agent in Punjab. In fact, in each village of Punjab, I'll have one agent. Call all the agriculturists, farmers, and say, supply to him, it is equivalent to supplying to me. The fellow who's been appointed as an agent is my recipient. He gets all the goods, keep in his stock, custody separately. He knows when my lorry comes, where my lorry comes. There he will come and upload. So this is how it will be done in case of agent acting on behalf of the recipient of supply of services. So it shall include, recipient term shall include an agent acting on behalf of the recipient. A very important term by name called as taxable person. Often we would refer the term taxable person. Taxable person means who is registered under GST. Similarly, any person liable for GST will also be treated as a taxable person. Followed by, we have another definition called as casual taxable person. What do we mean by casual taxable person? He is the one who occasionally undertakes transactions of business which is in nature involving business, and he does not have a fixed place of business in that state. He is who is not having a fixed place of business in that state. He is not having a fixed place of business in that state. However, he is not having a fixed place of business in that state. However, a point need to be noted down over here is he will not have a fixed place of business in the state. However, he would be engaging in business in that area. Now, how it is possible? Very simple. There is going to be an exhibition that happens in that area. There is going to be a trade fair that happens in the area. A supplier from another state, he has regular office, warehouse, godown, everything in another state, state 2. But from state 2, he comes down to state 1 and engaged in supply of services. Then, yes. So if this be the situation like this, our understanding could be, if this is going to be the situation like this, our understanding could be that person who comes from another state and going to do business here occasionally, that person will be treated as a casual taxable person. Okay. More about it when we go to a topic called as registration, we will discuss. Non-resident taxable person, again, a person who occasionally undertake transactions involving supply of goods. Sir, again, already we read, correct. But point of difference is, means a person who occasionally engage in transaction involving supply of goods or services. But who has no fixed place of business or residence in India. The only difference between casual taxable person and non-resident taxable person, both of them come to that state. In that state, they don't have office. But non-resident fellow does not come from next state. He comes from next country. There is an international photographer exhibition. There is an international printer exhibition. There is an international exhibition. For this exhibition, in case if this person is going to come,